My name is Petra Parikova. I'm the Associate Director at Stanford Center for Professional Development for our Computer Science, Cybersecurity, Artificial Intelligence programs and courses. And together with me, we have John Mitchell and Mark Mitchell. It's actually accidental that the surname is the same, which is actually kind of a fun fact, and they will tell you more about themselves. But just to introduce them very briefly, John is our great professor of computer science and by courtesy also of electrical engineering and education at Stanford University. And he's also currently the chair of the computer science department. And Mark Mitchell is like, you know, he has so much experience. It was so hard to pick one. So I would just say like he's computer science, scientist, entrepreneur, investor, like really excited about the topics of blockchain and Web3. And we are so grateful that they both took the time to join us today. Thank you so much for joining us. With that, I will hand it off to Mark and John. Thank you.
Hi. Good morning or good afternoon, wherever, a good evening, wherever you are in the world. It's great to get started and have a conversation this morning here in California around blockchain and Web3. Very happy to be joined by Mark. Let us each give a little short introduction to ourselves, and then we're going to talk about some applications and some main ideas and give kind of an overview for 15, 20 minutes, maybe half an hour, and then we'd love to hear questions from anyone in the audience about what you'd like to hear about and make this interactive if possible. So just a sort of background, I've been a professor of computer science here for a couple of decades. I worked on programming languages, computer security, network security. I spent a little bit of time looking at educational technology and things of that sort. And blockchain Web3 really relates to a lot of the interests and things that I worked on, you know, over many decades. You'll see there's contract languages, different kind of programming languages are involved in blockchain, and the underlying mechanism of consensus protocols is related to network protocols, network security, use of cryptography. In this particular area, one thing I did was take about 18 months to work part-time with the effort that Facebook initiated. It was called Libra for a while, then Novi. I spent about 18 months there, very part-time, just trying to see if I could be helpful and follow along on that. So that was a major effort to build a new blockchain, a new cryptocurrency, build some applications around it, and of course involved in courses and seminar talks on the subject. So I don't know everything. It's a big area. Things are moving quickly. But we'll try to give you an orientation to the main issues and focus on applications and why this can be interesting and exciting. Mark?
Yeah, so as Petra said, John and I are not related, but we do have the same haircut. And so we have that in common. I was one of John's students at Stanford, and I hate to tell you, John, it was more than a couple of decades ago, but a while. And as Petra mentioned, since then, I left Stanford. I didn't ever get my PhD. I went off and started a startup and eventually sold it. I ran a division in a big public company for a while, and then I got into investing in startups and serving on the boards of startups. And so now I've sort of wandered back and stitched the two halves of my career together. I'm now at SRI International, which is a nonprofit research lab. And so there I do computer science research, but I'm also working with them on spinning out technologies and investing in companies that can make use of SRI technology. So that's a fun bit. You know, both my research way back when with John was on cryptography and security, and obviously blockchain relates to that. So I've had an interest in this sector since it got started. And I have invested in a few Web3 or crypto companies, but mostly I haven't. And so I've avoided losing money on some bad crypto deals. And I've also avoided making money on good crypto deals. So I like John, I would not claim to be the world's deepest expert on any of this kind of thing, but I have a little bit more of perhaps the business perspective on it. So, John, we're going to talk about Web3, I guess we got to start with Web1, right? Do you want to?
Right. So this is just kind of perspective. It's really to explain the term Web3 and why it's used. So if you just think back in history, or look back at the way the web has developed. The web came into being after the internet was there in place as a way of building a kind of application layer and exchange of information over the internet. Web 1 was simply the protocols and tools for being able to write web pages, link them together, and read them. So this was created by physicists. They had physics experiments and papers and documents and pictures and data that they wanted to share. You could create a web page and link the different parts together, but there was not an interactive kind of medium. It was basically authors would build stuff and readers would use different means to find them. If you were following this back then, there was kind of a struggle, where are we gonna use directories? Yahoo was a big human created index into the web. And AltaVista and Google were these automated search. We didn't know at the time which was going to be more practical. Of course, in retrospect, it's kind of obvious. There's so much on the web. No single person, you know, or a group of 50 or 100 people could write, you know, an index to all the things you'd want to find on the web. The automation really took over. And I just mentioned that just to remind everyone, remind ourselves, that in the early stage of a technology, you don't know which of the parts of it are going to become the most successful later on. So moving through this, Web 2 is really where user input started to be possible. It's kind of the form field in a web page or form field in HTML, if you're familiar with that. With user input, then sites can become interactive. You could put up a questionnaire, people could write things into it. You could have social media, because where different users of a site contribute and add content to it. And along with that came this notion of who's writing what, you know, authentication via passwords, HTTPS, SSL, the use of website certificates and authentication both directions, so that users could authenticate themselves to sites. Sites are effectively authenticated by certificates. And that gives us kind of nice infrastructure for e-commerce, social media, and all these things that have had massive effect, not always uniformly regarded as positive effect, but you know, technology just keeps marching along and it upsets our world and changes things. And you know, if you wish we all had printed newspapers and you don't like social media, I think, you know, kind of we're out of luck. This is the world we live in, and it's different. And the same thing can happen with Web3. If you like going to the bank on the, you know, your neighborhood, you know, maybe that's great, but maybe it'll go away for some reason. So Web3 is really about, the term I think refers to the kind of application layer features and functionality and potential that can be built using blockchain as an underlying mechanism. So what does that give us as some options here? You know, in Web 2 and traditional websites, each page is hosted by one provider. Somebody wrote that, they put it on their server, that's where it lives. With a blockchain, the ownership of the content can be distributed and managed in a certain way. And we have these things that we'll talk about in more detail for asserting ownership, exchanging ownership, creating markets for the for buying, selling, trading, bartering, and using different kinds of tokens that represent ownership or membership in some group and so on. So I hope that's a helpful explanation of the term. Mark, did I miss something in the Web3? I feel like I wandered around the topic. It's a little hard to define crisply.
Well, no, I think you did good. And we can, maybe we go to the next slide and we'll get into some of the specific Web3 terms, and that'll help clarify it a little bit. So, you know, at the lowest level, we have this thing called a blockchain. And this is what's underlying Web3. There are a lot of words on this slide, but I think some of them are important. So the blockchain is a verifiable public ledger. What does that mean? Well, the verifiable part means any person can come and look at that blockchain and be convinced that it's authentic. The blockchain itself is a ledger, so it's something where we're adding more information to it. Nothing's ever removed from it. We keep adding things to the end. And the public means that anybody can add things and anybody can verify what's been added. And that verifiability allows us to say who added it and that it was a legitimate thing to add to the blockchain, that it really was added. Now, part of what the trick in this is the distribution aspect. So there's no single party, no person, no company that's maintaining the blockchain, at least when we talk about public blockchains. It's literally thousands or tens of thousands or hundreds of thousands of computers running all over the world. And there's some complicated cryptography and math to make that work in a reliable and reasonably secure way. And I'll say reasonably because there are issues around that, but that is the goal. So one particular use of the blockchain is cryptocurrency. And I think a lot of people sort of conflate cryptocurrency and blockchain as the same, but they're not. Cryptocurrency is just one use. So in cryptocurrency blockchains, the thing that's being added to the chain is who owns what piece of money, what Bitcoin or what piece of Ether. And as those move around, as they get transferred, as people pay each other, the blockchain keeps track of, well, who has it now? Where did it go? Who transferred it to whom? But there are other uses. And in fact, most of what we're going to focus on today is not cryptocurrency uses of blockchain. Another term that's part of this technology stack that underlies Web3 is smart contracts. We all know what contracts are. We've all signed contracts. But normally contracts are on pieces of paper or they're electronic documents, but they don't do anything by themselves. They're just documents. And then if somebody has some obligation under the contract and they don't live up to it, you have to sue them. You have to go to court. You have to find some way of enforcing the contract. These smart contracts are programs that are themselves embedded on the blockchain, and they run just like any computer program runs. So the program might say that John is going to transfer some Bitcoins to me or some Ether to me when some condition is fulfilled, and that program just runs when that condition is fulfilled and the transfer is completed. So the contracts are smart because they execute themselves. And then finally, the last term on the slide here is token. So we have these records on the blockchain that correspond to sometimes real things in the real world, like real estate or cars or some jet planes or paintings, but sometimes they correspond to something purely digital, like a piece of digital artwork or the right to play a particular piece of music or things like this. But those tokens can be traded around, for other tokens or for cryptocurrency, or they can be smart contracts, can move them from place to place. So, these are all some of the important terms that are part of the technology underlying Web3. But there are a lot more terms. John, do you want to?
So just for pacing and to kind of give you in the audience a little more sense of overview, we just wanted to make sure that we had defined in some way the key terms we're going to use. We're going to get back to explaining many of the things we alluded to in more detail through examples. And then this slide is even more kind of the landscape and not something we're going to go into in detail right now. But later on, if you have a question, if you'd like us to dig in on one of these portions of this picture, then please do. We'll have time for questions and audience input as we go. This is a picture that we created to try to put some things in order. So the key idea is this notion of blockchain, a ledger, a write-only verifiable data structure, and then all the different, many of the different ways it can be used. On the left, that branch represents how does a blockchain work. So we could dig into the technology. There's open blockchains. Anyone could try to become a maintainer of the blockchain, or closed. It's a private community of banks, say, that runs a bank blockchain. Then there's Ledger. These kind of, as we go to the right, it becomes more kind of more in the application area. What can you do with a ledger? What can we do with something where you can write stuff and the things you write never go away, but somebody else can write another thing that could supersede that? So we'll talk about some applications there. One big application, of course, and what got this whole area really going was the financial application, the invention of Bitcoin, which is a clever idea, both in its technology and its use. But lots of things there about how currency works, decentralized finance, different kind of financial infrastructure based on this. We'll say a little bit about DAO, distributed organizations that have usually financial impact. And then Web3 is kind of the broader term for the as yet not fully defined future, all the ways you can use tokens, create exchanges, and so on. So I hope that's useful as kind of a where we could go. And if we had a week, you know, we dig into all of these things, you know, this kind of brief webinar, you know, an hour at most, we're not going to be able to dig into all of these. But we wanted at this point to just give you kind of an overview of what some of the things are that you might have heard about or might be particularly interested in and how they relate to other concepts. Mark, any further comments on this sort of outline?
No, I think that's great. So maybe I'll talk about, I happen to notice we have a little window that we can see here that's got questions coming in, and we're going to take questions properly at the end. But one of the questions that came in is Web3 a solution in search of a problem? That's a really good question, and I don't actually know if anybody knows the answer. There are a lot of people who are confident they know the answer one way or the other, but I think the proof is in the pudding. We don't have much in the way of established Web3 utility at this point, but we sure have a lot of interest and a lot of money flowing into it. So I think a lot of people have the feeling that there ought to be something there. And this is an example of something that might be there. So we all have medical records. And your medical records come from lots of places. You know, you go to the doctor, you have the doctor writes things down, you go and get an x-ray, they put the x-ray in the medical record, you get your blood tested, they put that in the medical record. And this comes in over a long period of time. I'm 49 years old, so my medical record, I suppose, goes back 49 years, and hopefully there'll be maybe another 49 years of data on the next part of my medical record. So that has to all be kept track of over this long period of time with lots of different sources of information. And one of the interesting things about it is I really don't want most people to know what's in my medical record. It's private, it's my business. But of course, I do need my doctor to know it or my pharmacist to know it, and I, to some extent, need my health insurance company to know it. And if I'm in an emergency situation, if I'm in a car crash or something like that, I want the EMTs that are helping me to have access to that record. And I'd really like that record to be available worldwide. If I'm on vacation in Thailand or someplace, I would like the people there to be able to get my medical record. So the problem here, if we look at the current world, is that data is generally living in some individual company's servers. It happens I'm a Kaiser person, so Kaiser's got my medical record. I don't think there's any easy way for the EMTs to get at that data. They'd have to somehow get through Kaiser. It's not going to be there immediately. It's not easy to access. And it's not easy for somebody in a foreign country I might be visiting to add anything to the medical record. So that's a real problem. And it's the kind of thing that perhaps blockchain could help with. The blockchain is designed to have this long lifetime. The data is distributed around the world on all these different servers. So presumably it's harder for it to be disappeared or to be hacked. It's auditable. We can know who added things to it, when they added things to it, and control access to it in various ways. So at least potentially, I think, blockchain could help with this problem. John, what do you think?
Great idea. I thought we'd just kind of review kind of what are some of the features of blockchain that might be helpful in figuring out, is this an advance here or not? Why would blockchain be helpful? And just to review kind of what we alluded to, you know, blockchain provides this trusted public ledger that's decentralized. And one reason that this might be applicable to the medical record case is it's not clear who really owns your medical record or who should be the central person agency that controls it. It might be great if that's spread out and distributed all over the world. The way Mark mentioned, if you're on vacation, you're injured, you have an allergy to a certain kind of treatment or drug or something that someone might give you, it's great if that's available in many places. So in asking, is blockchain going to help? It's, you know, do we need a decentralized solution? And does it require some degree of trust, some degree of public visibility, and the property that information is persistent or that it's like a ledger in that sense? So what do you think about medical application there, Mark? Does it meet these criteria?
I think it does. I mean, I think these are to go back to that question of is Web3 a solution in search of a problem? I think it is a solution to a real problem. And I think the sort of problems that it's going to be useful for solving are those where you have data that has to live a long time and there's no one that you really trust to hold on to it. And you do need to be able to figure out who added things to that data set and when, so that you can do audits. And I think, you know, medical records are appropriate, fit those criteria. And I think the, you know, blockchains are even more useful when we really have to be able to verify that data or figure out if there's some value in them. Medical records may or may not have the value part of it, but they might.
So let me talk about another idea that's similar. And this is something that has had some traction. I was on the steering committee for an effort associated with the U.S. Department of Education to explore blockchains in education. And the organizational structure was that the Department of Ed in collaboration with the American Council on Education solicited proposals. The proposals, you know, were to get funding to build prototypes. And then four prototypes were built and tested and used, and it was meant to kind of test the value of blockchain in education. So let me just tell you about two of them. One was students in a particular region. I think Dallas was the area. And so someone might finish high school, go to community college. Often community college students go to more than one community college over a few years. Then they want to transfer to a four-year college. Then they want to get a degree based on transfer of those credits. So in that case, just the way Mark was explaining for medical records, no single organization feels responsible for all of the educational information, all of the grades and transcripts for a person who's transferred from one school to another. But in the region, Dallas, it's great to have this capacity, and it helps build the economy and provide education and certifiable skills for future employers to have that. So I think you can kind of see there that a distributed shared infrastructure that's trustworthy. No one wants to give a degree if someone lied about their transcript. We want to know that that's valid and so on. That's one application. Another one that I thought was very interesting had to do with credentials for teachers. Teachers are supposed to go and have continuing education regularly. And they, again, can go to many different kind of organizations for that. One of the blockchain pilots was to build kind of a national repository of teacher certification credentials, including this continuing education. And that way, teachers could have all of their information in one place. This had an unexpected consequence. And I think this is partly to that question, is this a solution in search of a problem? One of the things that you look for in an emerging technology is you suddenly have applications that you didn't think of at all, but are actually extremely valuable. In this educational certification for teachers, what that's blockchain suddenly became was a way for schools to find candidates and hire teachers. So if you had a biology teacher in high school in one city, you know, resign and leave, you need to hire another biology teacher, where would you find one? This blockchain with all this information about teachers and who's up to date on their continuing education provided a great way for school systems and districts to go out, reach out and find teachers. That, of course, is valuable for the teachers who are seeking jobs and get job offers. And it kind of accelerated and improved the infrastructure there in a way that no one had anticipated when they proposed this. But I thought it's an example of how the technology was useful, is that it gave us these unexpected consequences that in this case were very positive.
And I think that the verifiability is really important there, because you could go and look at that. You know, someone sends you a resume and you have to figure out what on the resume you believe and what you don't. So, you know, having something where I don't have to call your references, you have a signed cryptographically secure thing that says you got this credential from so-and-so. That's interesting.
Should we talk for a few minutes about applications in banking? I think there are many, but I just wanted to touch on this a little bit. If I wanted to send Mark a little bit of money, we went out for coffee, he paid for it, I want to pay him back, or you can imagine something else. You know, the current mechanism for me to send money from one person to another, the automated clearinghouse mechanism, is really very complicated. It has many different layers. It takes about 3 days for me to transfer money from my account to Mark's. You know, could we speed that up? Could we make it more efficient? Could we introduce new technology that would modernize that aspect of banking? A lot of questions like that. Which ones do interest you most, Mark, around this area?
Well, I guess I think that, you know, direct money transfer is one, but I think there are a lot of things that are analogous to that. When you buy and sell stocks, you have the same kind of settlement process. You know, you put an order in and it's not for 2 or 3 days that the stock is actually registered in your name. And if you sell the stock, it's a couple of days before you get the funds. And all of these systems have the same problem, that there are these multiple layers and cooperating parties that need some central trusted clearinghouse in your banking diagram. It's the central bank, and in the securities context, it's different central clearinghouses. But they need these organizations to record the stock is no longer in Mark's account; it's now in John's account. The money is no longer in John's account; it's in Mark's account. And getting that all recorded is time consuming and expensive. So there's certainly a potential for accelerating all of those kinds of transfers, particularly where they involve some kind of legal ownership right. So another thing I know people looked at a lot is real estate, and you go and buy real estate. You have a title company involved to make sure that the money's been provided from the buyer and that the seller has done all the things they need to do to transfer ownership to the new buyer. And then the title company also goes and records who owns the thing on a public ledger, which is the public ledger maintained by the county of who owns what parcels. So we already have this sort of public ledger concept in some places, like for a real estate title, but it's a paper ledger or a computer ledger maintained by a single party, not a decentralized auditable ledger in this way.
Yeah, I want to make one more point, and then maybe we'll go on to contracts and DAO and some more futuristic things. The reason why it takes 3 days for a bank transfer partly is just the way things are set up, but partly there's some fraud detection and ability to roll back or not complete fraudulent transactions. Sometimes the multiple layers, check and recheck, send and confirm and send again, two-phase commit, other kind of things that are in these kind of systems do serve a useful purpose in addition to slowing things down. And when we modernize banking, we don't want to have more theft than we have now, more fraud than we have now, you know, identity theft, suddenly empty your bank account. you know, there's a bunch of interesting security problems to solve as we think about modernizing banking or any other infrastructure with more efficient contemporary technology. Should we say a little bit about contracts and how they work, and then maybe DAOs are a good example to think about? What do you think is important?
Sure. I mean, I think this ties into the point you just were making about the benefits of some of the slowness. Smart contracts are, as we said earlier, they're really programs that execute automatically, and they can transfer money around. And there are good examples of errors in those contracts resulting in large hundreds of millions of dollars of transfers that shouldn't have happened. And there is no easy mechanism for undoing them. There isn't that slowness that allows you to notice that something's going wrong. There isn't even necessarily anybody to sue afterwards to get the money back. So there are real risks with these smart contracts.
An example. I'm going to loan you money and you're going to pay it back to me over time. So what we write into the blockchain is I'm going to, at a start date, maybe you choose the start date, a certain amount of money is transferred from my account to your account. And then let's say monthly thereafter, you pay me back a certain amount of money each month until we've reached some agreed upon point, which gives me back my principal and maybe a little bit of interest. So we would write that as a contract on the blockchain. It would execute automatically if we set it up that way and do the transfer. But if there was a bug in it, what would happen? Suppose I transferred twice as much money as I expected because there was a bug in it, or the payment amount was wrong, or it went on longer than we planned. You know, those kind of bugs, somebody would end up a winner and somebody would end up a loser. In this blockchain world, what happens in that case?
Yeah, well, I mean, what happens, there's one of two things. Either if you're the loser, you just lose, and that because, you know, the contract was the contract, or sometimes the community that's running the blockchain decides to essentially invalidate the contract, and they do what's called a hard fork, and they go and just sort of make like it never happened. Of course, that has the risk of being political. There's not a judge or a jury or a governmental system in there. So, it could be also that the contract is totally valid, but they decide that they don't like me and they like you, and then they might undo the transaction in some way. So there are a lot of things, and, you know, real world contracts have all these fuzzy bits in them where you have to make reasonable efforts and somebody has to do something unless there's a, you know, unforeseeable circumstance, an act of war or a natural disaster. All those things get written into these contracts, and they're kind of intentional fuzz to work around situations we can't anticipate up front. And one of the challenges with smart contracts is right now they're pretty black and white. And if we're going to use them for some of these more complicated situations, we'll have to figure out how to deal with some of that fuzz.
Should we talk about DAO? What do you think about DAOs?
Well, I guess we should define them first. So, you know, normally, like if you have a company, you have a bunch of shareholders that own the company, or if you have some other organization, you may have a board of directors for that organization that kind of control the organization and what it can do. And the idea of a DAO is that instead of doing that, we'll divide up the ownership or control amongst a bunch of people or entities based on how many tokens they own in some particular thing. And in many cases, then there are smart contracts in place that say if those tokens are voted to change the rules in some way, then the rules change. And this also, you know, it's very powerful. It means we can sort of start something looks kind of like a corporation or a company of some kind with people all over the world without any government being involved, et cetera. But it also means that if somebody gets too many of those tokens, they can change the rules in pretty surprising ways.
So maybe one example that occurs to me now, seeing the City DAO example, is something like a timeshare arrangement. You can go buy from Marriott or some other large company timeshare in a pool of, say, vacation properties. And you, by buying the timeshare, you pay a certain amount of money up front, you pay a certain amount each year, you might pay a little bit of incremental money for each use, but you're then entitled to, you know, two months per year for, you know, an extended period of time, or a certain number of credits to where different properties cost you a different amount of credit. But you have a centralized organization that offers, you know, the buyers as individuals a contract for use of this property. And then it's up to that centralized authority. Do they want to open a new vacation thing in another island in Hawaii, or move into another part of the world and expand? None of the owners necessarily get to vote on that. They get some consequences of evolution there. If we did that as a DAO, we would have some rules about who owns how many units or how many credits, how much do we pay. We could have voting of the organization. The whole structure could be written into a contract. Anyone could read the contract in principle. That would govern the operation of this timeshare. And it would work independent of some large organization that might be solvent now, might go out of business later. We would run this independently. Is that help illustrate many of the ideas here? What do you think about that example?
Yeah, I think that's a very good example, and I think it's worth noting. You know, there's a note at the bottom of the slide that some states are now recognizing these DAOs or as legal entities, or allowing them to register as legal entities. So there's kind of a crossover between the decentralized world of DAOs and the more regulated governmental world of normal corporate entities, and we're probably likely to see more of that in the future.
Yeah, so there's this city DAO, I think, is an interesting example. Owns a bunch of land. That's what reminded me of the timeshare example, and then collectively managed there. I think this is a nice. I think you may might. Oops. Now we had a little bit about what can go wrong. Maybe we should we talk about that now, or move on and come back to the DAO examples.
As you like. I mean, we could do one more example of how Web3 might be useful, or we could skip ahead to the ways it could, which it could fail horribly.
Well, let's put this other idea out there, because I think it's not really clear where this is all going to go, and why this technology could be revolutionary. I like this example because it moves a little bit beyond the, first we went with ledger, like record who owns stuff. Then we went to DAOs and contracts that can represent organizations and things that evolve. This is one that involves a market in an interesting way. So here's a possibility. I've heard this, a lot of startups, a number of startups have gotten into this area. I've heard pitches from, several of them. This is just one example of a early stage company in this space of royal.io. The idea is to see if some process, some innovation could in effect eliminate or replace some of the functions of record labels. So the idea here is to allow musicians, somebody who might create, but in any case performs a piece of music, to market that to a community openly. And what a musician, an artist can sell is a token representing a fractional share of future royalties from that song. So it could be a rapper, it could be a person, a folk singer with a guitar, it could be a string quartet. You record that piece of music and then you make it available on this or another site. And somebody who's a fan of it says, oh, I think that's gonna be a hit. That's totally awesome. Everybody I know should listen to that song. It should be in our next dance mix. I'm investing in that. I'm gonna pay certain amount of money now, $100, $200, and I'm gonna get a 10th of a % of all the future royalties that are accrued from playing that music you know, in any public kind of space or on this site when it's used in that way. So individuals who are fans of music can invest in future royalties. Now, what's the benefit to the musician? The musician who offers these tokens for sale, you know, suddenly gets paid right away, a small amount, but they've only signed off a certain fraction of their future earnings. Maybe they'll keep 50% or most, but they get money to support their, cover their cost of living, maybe make a small amount of money if they're successful. It's a marketplace for fans to engage with artists, for artists to get early stage funding. And really, because people who invest then might tell their friends, it could help with the spread and sale and popularization of a piece of music. So I think this is a pretty interesting idea. It's really not something that exists now. It's something that really I don't see how you would do this without these tokens representing digital ownership. You know, a token is like a stock share, giving you rights to future earnings from this music. And once these things exist and have value, they could be traded. So if I bought shares in future performance rights and revenue from a piece of music, and it started to become more popular, I could say, well, okay, fine, I'm going to sell it to somebody else who wants to own that for the future. I just was in it for the first early stage, and I want to go use the money to buy tokens representing some other new, undeveloped, unheard of artists. So I think you can kind of imagine how this would work. And it's a pretty interesting idea. And it does change the music business in a way that could be better for artists, could be better for fans. What do you think about that, Mark?
Yeah, I think that's right. I think there are a lot of nascent sort of generalizations of these ideas that, you know, right now we have markets for different things, but they're often physical markets, or even if they're electronic markets, they're sort of very separate electronic markets, and they're segregated. I mean, the American stock exchanges are only accessible, you know, really easily to Americans. And, you know, thing like even for Americans, then buying stocks in foreign companies can be difficult. And there's all these sort of artificial restrictions in some sense. And part of what blockchain does in this example shows is possible is to create sort of worldwide markets where we're leveraging some shared infrastructure, the blockchain, to buy and sell things that right now we might not be able to easily buy and sell.
Right. So I think that we're kind of coming to we wanted to give a bunch of examples first rather than talk about the technology to see if we get people excited about it. I think there's a lot of potential here. As Mark mentioned, huge amount of interest from investors. You know, some of the venture funds that are focused on blockchain and Web3 have a lot of, represent a lot of investor interest in the sector. There's just so much energy. The total dollar value in Bitcoin, Ether, and so on is you know, really massive. There's so much energy around this, and yet sort of skepticism of why and what is it doing and what problem is it solving. I thought it would be interesting to just talk about some possible futures that this technology unlocks and think about it that way. So we talk about global medical databases, education databases. There are lots of things you can think about recording this way. And then I like this music contract kind of example, because not clear how you do that any other way. How would you create an open exchange for digital contracts that you know don't exist now? And there are many, many other kinds of examples here that would be interesting. Do you want to mention any others, or should we take a look at the questions? I like your, do you want to talk about helium or any of the other kind of futures?
I mean, there are tons of these interesting things. So yeah, I mean, helium is this idea for Wi-Fi hotspots that would be incentivized with tokens. I was reading this morning about a company that wants to do private jet ownership, partial ownership that way, so you can sell the hours you're not using on your private jet to somebody else who wants to go somewhere. There are tons and tons of ideas down this path, but I think we've hit enough of them to give kind of the general overview.
So what about some things that go wrong? I think we're, you know, we're in a context where of talking about security, or we have a computer security certificate program here, and we're hosted by our friends who help us run that. Is this all like pie in the sky? Is this all going to work out easily, or what do you think? What do you think about that?
I think there's a lot to be done. And so the things on this slide are sort of technical issues, but there's also a lot of legal and regulatory issues. And again, I've seen a couple of questions go by about, you know, how do you pay taxes on the royalties you earned on your record label? And does the IRS know that you made that money? And, you know, how does that get handled? So there are a lot of technical and regulatory questions, but some of these are purely technical. I don't think we probably have time to go into any of them in detail, but, you know, this DAO hack, there was a bug in a smart contract that resulted in gazillions of dollars being, you know, transferred unfairly. And it's kind of a straightforward bug, like a software bug. It's not like some of these things are not new. It's just that all of a sudden we have code running that has the potential to move $150 million around. An error in the code, instead of causing a crash in your app and you have to restart it, instead is, you know, moves 150 million bucks someplace. All the things on that previous slide are kind of that flavor. They're applications in cryptocurrency to problems we've known about either in software or in finance in the past.
Why don't we look at some of the questions? We have about 10 minutes left maybe Petra, do you want to point us to something, or we can scan and see?
That's great. I can point you to a few. And since you just now talked about the attack, or like the DAO attack, there were a few questions about the cybersecurity threats of like the Web3, or like anything you would like to share about that area.
Yeah, so maybe I'll start, and then Mark will have some thoughts too. This last summer, we had a more than a week, almost 10 days of Web3 and blockchain kind of conferences here in August. We had originally planned to run them in January, but we still had some pandemic issues. They were all delayed to the end of the summer. One was the Science of Blockchain Conference, which is really about blockchain and underlying technology and some applications, sort of mostly the left half of this or so. And then I co-organized and helped run a decentralized finance security summit, sort of in the middle of this picture, looking at all of kind of security issues and problems that come up in decentralized finance. And it was very interesting. We had about 1,200 people sign up for the conference to come here. That's a lot of interest. One of the areas where it was clear there's a lot of activity is that if you are an auditor, if you are a person or a company that builds tools, or a person who uses tools to find bugs in code that does things like move money around, you have an infinite amount of work now. There's so much interest in looking at the applications. That drives a huge market for finding bugs and looking for them. If you just look at bug bounty for finding software bugs in blockchain systems, that gives you some idea of how valuable a bug is. If somebody's offering $1 million per bug, then that means they stand to lose a lot more than $1 million if they don't find that bug. I thought that was very interesting. Maybe to add one more specific from that, one of the areas that's very sensitive and important to get right are these notions of bridges between different chains. So if you have two different currencies represented in two different ways, either on the same underlying chain, like they're both built over Ethereum, or they use different chains entirely, you have two different notions of currency or items of value, and you want to find a way for people to exchange one for the other. The code that forms that bridge has to have the ability to destroy currency on one chain, create currency on the other. And so the code that has the permission to do that would be very valuable to take over. Like if you could compromise a bug in one of those systems, that can create and destroy currency. You could create currency at will. And so bugs in those kind, that kind of software are extremely important. So that's kind of diving into a specific, but I hope it's an illustration of where there's interest, where there's activity, and why finding bugs and eliminating security vulnerabilities can be so important in an area where there's so much money involved.
Great, thank you so much. I have seen quite some questions about ensuring the privacy of the data and like making sure that, you know, your data is secure, but then on the other hand, like making sure the party you are providing the data to like trust the data, right? And make sure that everything is valid on their end. So there have been quite some questions about these elements, like privacy, like making sure that the data doesn't escape anywhere, like, you know, we don't lose it. Like, how do we make sure this?
Yeah, I think maybe the medical example is a good one there. If we had a blockchain of medical records, you know, how would we begin to look at that, Mark? What are your first thoughts on that?
Well, I think some of these are normal cryptography questions. So we, you know, we do have ways we trust reasonably well to encrypt data so that only the intended people can read it. And we have pretty good ways of signing data so that we know that the data came from the person we think it came from. Of course, some of that is, you know, technological, but then there's always the problem of, well, if you hold a gun to my head and you make me give you your, you know, my secret password or my signing key or my thumb so you can use my thumbprint, you know, then something looks like it came from me, but really I was unwilling because I had a gun to my head. So there are all these things that are sort of go beyond the computer technology side of it. But I think in the medical records case, you know, you would encrypt most of the data so that it couldn't be read by just anyone, but you want to make it decryptable pretty easily. And I think biometric keys would make sense because in that emergency situation, you actually want the EMT to be able to put your thumb on a thumbprint reader and decrypt the data. Or maybe you wear a dog tag around your neck that has a secret code on it.
So to walk through that a little bit more, first of all, we've talked about a blockchain providing a verifiable public ledger. So public make it seems like everything is visible. But if what's visible is encrypted data, then visibility doesn't give you access to the data. In this medical case, if you went to a lab and had an X-ray, that would be stored on the blockchain, encrypted in some way. But now we have the problem of who gets the key to read that, and a huge key management problem. So I think what you're suggesting is the patient or the patient's primary care physician, somehow we need a permission system for decryption and visibility that lets those people see it. And then there's this emergency use, which is one of the big benefits. We also need some way for, in an emergency, someone to have access to data. And the way things often work in the medical field is you have a kind of break the glass, it's an emergency, let me see this. And then something that blockchain is very good at, recording that happened.
Right.
And then you have audit and recourse. If somebody claimed there was an emergency, looked at all my medical records, but it wasn't an emergency, that would be recorded in the blockchain indelibly. And I or someone else could go as an enforcer and go after that person and try to sue them or fine them or prevent them from being able to have access in the future.
Yeah, that's right. But I think it's also right to point out the complexity of, you know, how we manage all those, you know, all those keys and all those mechanisms. And I think that's, you know, that's part of the challenge in really deploying this kind of technology at scale and in these mission critical cases is, you know, all the policies and procedures that go behind it. Yes, there are these computer security problems and bugs in software, but there's also these more policy driven questions of what do you want the rules to be and how are you going to, you know, set things up so that that works that way.
So here's another question in a different direction that I saw earlier on, but I thought it was interesting. for us to kind of touch on it. It said, you know, Web 1, Web 2, there are standards. And that's kind of what defined the web. What are the standards of Web 3? And one thing that occurred to me is kind of the wallet and wallet protocols. If you're going to have an exchange of tokens representing ownership of digital or physical goods, people have to store those tokens somewhere. And we need an infrastructure and a standard for doing it. The whole idea of this music tokens is anybody could buy them, anybody could sell them. They're not locked up in a proprietary way. So we need an open standard for that. So I would just point to the wallet protocols and the things there that are the beginning of where standards are emerging in order to create those exchanges.
Yeah, and there actually are a bunch of emerging, I mean, it's wallets, but NFTs and even the way some of the smart contracts are done, they're emerging sort of draft standards of various forms. And they're not necessarily coming from the usual standards bodies, ISO or ANSI or these kinds of organizations. They're, you know, it's a wild new world. So they're emerging themselves as sometimes the outputs of DAOs and, you know, other such things.
Great. Thank you so much. We will be slowly wrapping up, but if you have any recommendation in terms of books, articles, anything to follow, to read, so people can stay up to date after this webinar, like if you have any recommendations, I'm sure people would really appreciate it.
Sure. Moment. I mean, I think the oldest, the historical things on blockchain are interesting. There's a nice book by four authors from Princeton about, you know, Bitcoin and kind of lays out things in an easily readable way. I think what I've found really is, you know, books take a while. There are some on the emerging things, but also there's a lot of really good short videos by various people on how different components work and then, you know, what the future is. And if you look into that, you'll find advocates and believers, and you'll find skeptics. And that's kind of accurate for where we are on this. Mark, are there things that you know about that you'd recommend?
Not specifically. I mean, I tend to get a lot of information from everything from, you know, good news sources. The Wall Street Journal or The Economist often have articles about these things. So those are kind of high level on the business side, and that there are some really good technical blogs where people post the more the computer science stuff or the latest security hacks and so forth. You know, so it's sort of informal searching around, I think, as good as anything.
Amazing. Thank you so much, Mark. Thank you so much, John. Thank you, really much. Thank you. I appreciate the time you took to join this webinar. Thank you also everybody who had a chance to join. We will share the recording with everybody. So if there's a part you might have missed, you can rewatch it. Or like if you would like to hear them again, I'm sure you will. You can rewatch it once again. And yeah, like we will be in touch with more information. If you would like to know more about us or about the courses we are offering, you can find it on the comments. So, or like in the follow-up email. Yeah. Thank you so much.
Great. Good to see everybody. Great.
Have a nice day.